I have a great honor and privilege in welcoming Rahul Kurav, Digital Imaging Head and Colorist at FutureWork Studio. Rahul has been a leading figure in this industry for almost over two decades now, and his experience extends across visual effects to color grading to the entire stream of animation. Having started his career with Crest Animation, one of the pioneering animation studios set up in the late 90s by Mr. Shyam Ravanna, Rahul is today one of the top color grading artists we have in the country, and he has immense projects to his credit to boast of. Rahul, without wasting much time, I would like you to give us a brief walkthrough of your journey over the past two decades.
Okay, thanks Manoj for calling me over here for the show, and I hope everyone's pretty much safe at home, and everyone's taking proper care for the current pandemic. Just to take the things ahead, I have been in the industry for a pretty long time, since 1991, and this has been quite a journey, and it's still a long journey ahead, I can foresee it. The whole business of animation, visual effects, digital imaging has been a big transformation in the last decade, I would say. And there has been a much more understanding of this subject, which has been conveyed to the media, by the media to the masses, and a lot of more talent, much more exposure is offered, and the ease of technology and use has really made the entire process very palatable to a lot of people, unlike the earlier days where we had to really find some kind of information to do some kind of a work. So there has been a huge curve that is there, and that's a very positive curve that we can see. To tell you briefly, yes, I started my career in Sir J.J. School of Arts, J.J. School of Applied Arts actually, where I did my commercial arts and I specialized in photography, and that is where I actually wanted to do visual effects since my third year of college. That was in about 1987 onwards, and I started heading towards that direction. Yes, I had to come a little bit of a different way as opposed to what people would normally like to do is, I actually went out to start doing programming, because that was the only option for us to get into doing computers. Otherwise, nobody even allowed us to touch a computer in those days. So yes, as opposed to what we have today. But that actually gave a very big background to this whole subject, because we had to learn the video technology on location in real time and be practical about it. We got the opportunity to work on the development that happened, and being with Crest and being with Shyam, he always had this whole idea about where the technology is moving, how to make use of technology, how the things are really going to work out for the visual content and the visual intent that we have to do. And that is what was driving a force with us. So it was a whole culmination of technology and aptitude for all of us to really make an image and communicate through that. So visuals have been passing through various transformations in the earlier days through different machines, different signals, different situations, different monitoring devices, different acquisition devices, like we used to earlier shoot on 35mm negative. Cameras used to be there used to be 16mm, there used to be a beta cam, there used to be a digi beta cam which eventually came in. There were a lot of these vision mixers, live gears, switchers. But the whole idea is, there was an image, and the road to find this visual that we were looking on, the animation, the communication, the urge to keep moving on and, you know, stretching the limits of these machines with the ideas. We started developing it. And that's what is happening even today, if you look at it, you know. Those were the days earlier, and what is that today? Even we have the tool sets, the softwares, everything that comes to us, and then we are trying to stretch it. So the whole base is absolutely the same, that, you know, we are trying to go beyond our limits, and we are making use of that today. So color, if you look at it, has been there for a long time. initially it wasn't given that importance, but yes, it was always having that importance right from the days of Telecine. And that is where we actually started knowing that color is a very important aspect. There used to be a color corrector called as a Harlequin color corrector in analog days, which was there. And we could do two channels of, as in two layers of color correction. It was a little difficult that time because there used to be these pods. But that was used mainly for doing online work during, online finishing sessions on Betacam or DJ Betacam machines. So, and plus there used to be also various other tool sets that came in for adjusting the colors, but not to the refinement of what a Telecine machine would offer. And now with the non-linear mode, we have possibilities which are endless now. And also at the same time, huge amount of development in color has happened. The display technology has changed. The images have started seeing much more bit depth, so we are seeing much more shades and tonalities of colors. Same thing applies because then the visual effects in this business also comes in the same fashion, that they also have to use a larger color space and a larger gamut so that they can get much more detailed information. The texture maps are much more higher now. The machines are supporting that kind of a firepower. So if you look at it, there is a whole, it's an amalgamation, it's a fusion of things that really make an image. So color in that now is a big form. You understand that it's not just a simple color, because it has got a huge application. The implications of colors are not simple. They really go a long way. They have this whole thing about something which has been taught to us, something that really came to us, color communicates something to you, and that is what is there. So that is how the journey for me is, and I can see that it's still going to go a long way. So it's not going to be that easy. It's going to be more challenging. It's going to be a very adventurous thing. So far, it has been a very good adventure. Rough rides, ups and downs, definitely. Those are going to be a part of our journey. And I think we all should really go for it and ride it out. So yes, this is where the journey begins for color. And yeah, having a large VFX background, handling various commercials, has a huge amount of base to understand with the whole thing concerned. So yes, Manoj, that answers thing.
Yeah, so I would like to start with visual imaging as a subject. Okay. Composition and color, how do you look at the entire aspect?
See, as I had mentioned to you, visual imaging has been the most important aspect for everything. It may be because of color, it may be because of animation, it may be because of 3D generation. We can definitely work on a black and white image as a 3D object, and then we can say, oh, this is what it is all looking like. But when colors are added to it, it gives a different dimension to it. Realize the fact. So, color as a subject, if you look at it, what I have been coming through and what I have been taught is, it is more of a human nature. It's extremely organic. And that means that each and every color, shade, tonalities, each and every color placement or the amount of color, it has a meaning. It just does not happen that I'm putting something here. For example, every day we wear some kind of a colorful clothes. We don't always wear black and white. Well, unless until you go down to a coat, which is always black and white. But besides that, when you look at it in reality, there's a color which is there in our life every day. We wake up with seeing colors around us. We wake up seeing different forms having color. So they have a certain role to play for us. And it is a very subconscious thing that has been going with us as a human thing. It's we wear something for a day, that color, it sort of somewhere down the line we communicate what is our mood, what is our ideology, or what's our personality. So now when you think about it, this color or colors are eventually transformed into images for communication.
Tell us about the importance of color, the daily application, motion, still imaging, displays. What is your thought take on that?
It's a very subconscious medium of communication. most of the time, I would say 95% of time, color becomes a very subconscious way of communication. Except for a few things, like today we have the signals and stuff like that, which do have colors and they signify some kind of importance to that, like for example red and green, orange and stuff like that. Colors, lights are used for signaling in a lot of aircrafts or even for ships or, you know, various other things that are there. When we were studying color in our institution, we had various assignments that we did. We have been taught about what do you mean by color theory, what are the different types of colors and what are the different palettes that you can do with it. And we eventually, and it's happening now also in all the art institutions, that we have to do color compositions, we have to do color balancing, we have to do understand what are the color size, the weight. And when it gets applied into any kind of a form for a commercial application, you know, we can actually see what it all communicates. So there is a large amount of, you know, understanding to know where the things are going to be communicated. So let's assume that today we are doing some kind of a animation or a 3D modeling. You know, the things also is the same thing, that we cannot just do everything in black and white. Okay, till the time we don't add color to it, we don't give a dimension. So now that actually signifies that color has a big amount of dimension to it, and it actually gives us that kind of a volume that we can speak about today, about what do you mean by color, you know. So when we talk about motion industry, colors, as I told you, they play a very subconscious effect on our mind. So a movement of color also makes a big difference on our mind. It also gives us a lot of psychological illusions. I won't say psychological illusions, but illusions which, you know, we can interpret what it is all about. So when you say applying it, yes, there is a thing. And when you say about still images, it's a different story, because we see one photograph for a pretty long period of time, so we can have a more communication happening on a still image. While in a motion communication on color, the movement is there continuously. So the colors are also moving, and that actually makes a big difference to understand and communicate. It's just not a colorful thing. For example, image of a Holi, you know, somebody's playing a Holi and somebody takes a picture on an iPhone or, you know, any of the phones, and then you watch it and say, oh, it looks nice. But the same thing, you have it, take a video of it, and you know, the moment is lost because somebody is splashing the color and it's all over. Okay, the thing would have just gone over in a second, and you cannot sometimes enjoy that. The whole thing about what happens in this kind of a situation is the color and the sequencing has to have that kind of the image persistence somewhere should be there in a human mind. Okay, so X-Person shoots a still, and X-Person shoots a motion or a video, you know, on two phones, one on the still phone and one on the motion phone. And then you see the colors of the same Holi, they don't look as vibrant sometimes when you see a video, but they look at it when you see a still. So the challenge happens here is, how do you make this color look more vibrant, and, you know, one has to make a person feel that yes, he was a part of the Holi. So you have to treat it like that. And that is where the color actually comes in, and cinematography comes in here. So now let's talk about why cinematography and art direction also comes as a big thing for color today. So eventually, color grading is the last stage in any of the subject, okay? Because that's where the finishing happens. It all starts from designing your image and your composition. That means it starts from the art director, the director, first and the director who has a vision, which gets enhanced using the art director and the cinematographer's vision on top of it. The compositions are done. Then again, something which is very important, two very big aspects is the costumes. The form, as I told you, of color also communicates, and the shape. So costumes play a big role in what are the color costumes that have been used, and the form of it, as in what type of color the costumes and the things have been used. Then something which is also extremely important is the makeup. So it's when you actually put the whole thing together, you have the set, colors, scheme, the patterns, the forms used in there, then you have the costumes using in there. you have the makeup. And then comes one of the biggest thing that really changes the image. Those are the lights. So, putting all this thing together, there is a lot of action happening in image. So now, where does color come in picture? It comes in each and every part of it. So let's say that you have a light which is a color in there of a different temperature or a specific temperature which a cinematographer wants. Then you have the light which changes the nature of the color on the costume, on the makeup, on possibly the jewelry or whatever the things have been worn. And then you have the light which again changes the color on the set, on the props out there. So when you look at it, it's a big play that is happening. And that needs a lot of sensitivity. So the person who really looks into it is a cinematographer who sees it from the viewfinder and from his lenses. And that is how we see a image, and that has got color in there. So where does the role of an actual colorist come into picture? His role actually comes into really balance the whole thing out, because it's not something which is an easy task. Because as I told you, a motion and a still, they have a different application. Sometimes to be more on the motion picture, you have to understand what do you mean by color and motion, because it is always changing. A human mind always sees the color in motion, as opposed to sometimes in the still in our day-to-day life. So we need to give that real life experience to audiences. So the challenge is just not what you call it as shooting something. It's also presenting it of something. Then after that, we have one of the biggest challenges in our today's day's world. And those challenges have been there for a pretty long time. A, the displays that have been used for communication, which means that we have now various types of displays that come into. For example, we have a theater, which is a large screen. Then we have a television which comes into a house. Mind it, in that also there are various television types. You have the CRTs which are virtually non-existent now, or they are still there but in a very small amount. Then you have the LCDs, you have the LEDs, then you have the OLEDs, and then various new things are coming up, other big walls, color walls which are in the LCD walls. Then one of the biggest things that has happened, and that's a big revolution, and I feel that's a very, very potent thing for us to really understand, are our cell phones and our tablets that we use for our computing and communication. Now, each and all these displays, they have certain limitations in how much colors can they accommodate in their screens. And that is where we talk about color spaces. We talk about whether it's a color space which are defined by some of the standards committee like SMPT or EBUs, you know, like you have something which can accommodate a certain volume of colors. For example, you have Rec 709, which has been a standard for a very long time, which has a certain volume of colors and certain light levels that can accommodate in there. Then you have another color space called as a P3, as in a primary 3, R, G and B, which eventually is been used for theaters, that is for screens. Then you have a new color space which has been there for a long time, but now it's been actually used commercially, is a Rec 2020. Now that has been used more for a high dynamic range imaging, where you have much larger color volume to be there. So all these colors that we do now, when you look at it back, okay, so let's look at it, that a director visualizes a scene, then you have the art director coming into picture, then you have the costumes coming in there, then you have the makeup, then you have the cinematographer, the lights, and the camera, and then after that everything looks fine into that medium of camera, but it has to be delivered down to a theater, a home television, a cell phone, a tablet, or your laptops, you know, different types of laptops. So the colors are going to change, because they will interpret the colors in each in their own languages. So these standards are made to follow a certain routine. So there is a baseline which comes to us, and we have to follow that. Hence, Now, when you look at it, it gets a little bit more complex. I'm trying to try and explain it to you in the most simplest way possible. That's what I feel. Then we have to deliver our final finished product to our audiences. Okay, that is our job. That's the job of a studio, a colorist or an animator or some anybody who creates images or he enhances images by his tool sets. May it be a composite in things or an animated 3D thing or a 2D animation. All these things put together, you have to understand how a color is going to react for each and every scene or for a display, not a scene, for a display right now. That's what we are talking about, right? For example, a red, a green, and a blue will have a different value when it goes onto a projection. The same color, when you see it on a Rec 709 in a home television, it will have a different value. Then you see it on to the same thing on a cell phone or any other thing, it will have a different value. So what happens is you have to have this understanding of how you have to play with the colors for each and every medium. Now, if I have to put an analogy together of an artist, when I'm painting myself or using my canvas, I have to be very cautious of what time of the day I'm doing my painting. Whether I'm doing my painting in the morning and is it going to be in the afternoon or in the evening? Because it makes a difference. The light makes a difference to what I'm seeing. Okay, so the ambient light also plays a difference today. That what colors I see in the morning will not be seen the same thing in the afternoon and the same thing in the evening. And the same thing happens when you're watching displays today, which is a big problem for all of us. And we have to understand, being in the medium of broadcasting and communication and for delivery of our content, that we are seeing our cell phones being watched in a broad daylight, in fluorescent lighting conditions and in various situations. So the colors are going to change continuously. So understanding of where and how you want to do the color and especially motion becomes more tricky. As I told you, it's not easy for a person to keep the illusion of colors in someone's mind. It has to be delivered to all of us in a very easy way. It has to be, people should easily understand, those beautiful colors which are there, the beautiful situations, which we see a lot of us are doing today, a lot of colorists who are doing. They're really generating some beautiful images which look like that. But these are the challenges which I'm telling you that happens, okay? And the whole community is really pushing their limits today. If you ask me that how to make use of this kind of a technology to give the best experience to our audience today. So when we are now saying what it is all about, to be a little bit more on to the realities, we are dealing with color spaces for displays. So our limitations are there to the displays. So, okay. This is one of the biggest thing that happens to any colorist, that he understands what a display is about. He understands the digital acquisition of from the cameras, of what are the limitations and what are the advantages, okay? The pros and cons of using the cameras, and what will the camera or the cinematographer who has shot will be interpreted on the images. So this is where the role of an actual colorist comes into the picture. That is one of it, okay? The second thing is to enhance the image. That's the second part of it. And the third part is to go beyond what has been shot and really create something from there to deliver a visual experience. Because not every time it's possible for somebody to be on the set and create a look which is going to be there for us. We need to create that knowing our parameters and how we want to communicate and what is our final intent of communication for a medium. So a color is, if you have to look at it, we need to talk about it more, you have to segregate in each and every part. Like for example, now you have to understand what is a camera, which camera you are using it, because each and every camera has their own color spaces. Then you have to understand which are the softwares that you're going to use for color grading. Now the softwares, if you ask me, are like, for me, they're like pencils, they're like poster colors, they're like oil paints, they're like watercolors, acrylic colors, you know, crayons, everything that are there. So you, these are the tools that are there to give to us. What is the main important thing is to understand how the image is been captured and where it is to be delivered. And which tool are we going to use to make use of it? So trying to say that camera is like it's something that comes to you. I don't know how I can define that, but our final canvases are our display mediums, like our cell phones or, you know, our screens which are there or something like that, you know. And the tool sets are our softwares which actually give you the liberty to, you know, paint or, you know, use them to create something out of it, and how you want to use it, how you want to manipulate your tool sets. So learning these tool sets and the basics become a very, very, very important and a very integrated part of this whole process.
Okay, Rahul, please tell us about some of the important projects that you've executed over the so many years where color has played an important role.
Manoj, I have been quite a situations, quite a few situations which are there, and some of them are pretty new, some of them are pretty much done a couple of years ago. As a matter of fact, there are some projects which not many people would be aware of also. I'll tell you, there is something which is very, very much the way the new thing people are talking about it, and we have done that quite a long time ago. We had this whole project which FutureWorks got because we committed ourselves to doing that thing, is that we said we'll do an on-set color previsualization, and that was initiated by two people, and that is Rohan Sippy and Amit Roy. Amit has been a very good old colleague, I would not say one of our people who always has pushed the limits for things in camera. And Rohan always has been a part of developing technologies and using technologies for all the work. So this thing was, how do we do that kind of a color pre-visualization on location when it was analog days? Digital cameras were just seeing some kind of a light into the picture. So that's the time when we devised that, yes, we used to scan the negative, we used to do the color correction and watch it. What we had to eventually do that time was to really, after processing the negative, we had to transfer it like a scan. So we had to devise a way of how the log images are, and they have been treated as a log images, capture it onto a non-linear system and send it as a physical MOV file. So if you look at it, what we eventually did for color is we stimulated a raw file, a log file. I would not say raw file, it's a log file. And then we started color correcting on location. So there was a delay of nearly 3 days because the shooting was happening. We had to process it, do a telecine of it, make the marking of it, and send it across to location where the rushes were graded. And the director would see it, the cinematographer would see it, and the producers were very happy. So yes, that is where we started doing that processes. For this, we had to understand what are color spaces that we are going to do, how the colors are going to transform in different color spaces, how they are going to be interpreted finally for our delivery and for our final sessions for big screen, because we are watching it on video, it's going to be on a big screen. So all those parameters had to be taken into consideration. Now this is what we said, that we study a lot of color today. It's not simple like we can understand the system. Understanding a system is not understanding a color, it's understanding the entire process of what the colors are going to be transformed. So now this is where it was the first thing I would say we attempted it, and the whole movie Dhammaradham was pre-visualized off-site. Okay, on site, off-site in the sense of the studio, but on location it was pre-visualized, and it was something that we could really push ourselves by treating it in a different way. Then now today we are doing a live color grading sessions, which means that we are actually today in one of the films. I can't tell you possibly right now, but yes, for Jersey, we are doing live color grading and we are pre-visualizing how the whole image is going to look like and how we want to treat it. So the technology has changed, it has given us a lot of advantages of this thing. So that is one of the projects which I would say is of a very big importance to me, and that's going to be there for an extremely long period of time. That Dhammarodham actually became jumping or a stepping stone for us to really push our color and technology ahead. Then we have had this another beautiful project which was done by Mr. Kiran Devans, and that was Do Paise Ki Dhoop Charane Ki Barish, which I said was very important because that movie actually went into one of the well-known color palettes today. That's what Mr. Devans had mentioned to me recently. Something which was very ambitious and very different those days was a movie called Shabri, which very few people would be aware of, but that has been a very stylized film. If people get an opportunity, they can see it online today. Now talking about recent movies, yes, there has been Roy, which has been again treated, shot by Himan. It was shot on red, and what we did actually that time was we used camera RGB color space to grade it, and which was a very different thing, and we got a different look from there. So, you know, to understand, to get a look, you have to understand what the colors are going to do to you. So I used that, and that was really brilliant. Again for Himan, I again used another movie called Kala Kandi, where three cameras have been used and we used different color spaces for each and every cameras because we gave a different texture to that. Then of course, something which everybody talks about today is Aces. Now, what do you mean by Aces? Aces is another thing which everybody thinks, oh, it's something big and all that. Yes, the first film which I did on Aces was okay, don't get surprised, but it was Notanki Sala, and that was years ago. And after that, yes, there have been many films which I did on Aces, and I've been doing that. Couple of other things which happened, Sultan was there, so that also happened in Aces. And then there have been various projects that kept on working on Aces, and we started learning Aces curve, how it is going to implement and how best it's going to work for all of us. We had this whole thing about color spaces and projects which get associated each and every time because we could generate different look. So use of these color spaces and projects, they made a big difference. Today we talk about, yes, some of the projects which have been really done big blockbuster things, as I told you, was Shootout at Wadala, and Shootout at Wadala. And then you had Sultan, then you had something like Tiger Zinda Hai. We had War also, which we did recently. Bharat was another one which also did a very big chain. At the same time, there have been some of the other web episodes like Mirzapur happened, and there was Inside Edge, it happened. There's a Mirzapur season 2 coming in. So the treatment, the use of color spaces, the use of technology to take advantage of our color grading styles, the way we want to interpret the images, deliver it, you know, it all blends together. So these are some of the projects which I would like to say. They are of importance to me as an artist. Okay, it's not just something which are there. There are various other projects done by some of our colleagues also here in my studio and in other studios also, which are very brilliant and they are very executed very nicely. And we can see the use of technology, use of color codings, or the color things that have been used. Not in India, yes, we are doing it a lot today and people are understanding it, and we can see the development is coming through today. So if I ask me, these are some of the few which are there. Are a lot of other projects also which I may have skipped. Please excuse me, there are lots of them, I must tell you that. Some of the one which actually does, I still remember, and it was a very tough call for me, was there's a Marathi movie called Kaul, which was shot on 5D, if I'm not, 5D, and I had used that thing. It was shot with no light and it was shot in the night. So that's a place where I actually made use of the color spaces to take advantage of that situation and really deliver something different. So when you look at it, it's not about the color, about what we talk about. It's about understanding of color, how much you want to deliver and where you want to deliver and how you want it to be interpreted. So color is just not about color grading as such. Color grading becomes a separate topic. But yes, when you're talking about color, you have to be sensitive towards it. You have to be very, very cautious about all these things when you are delivering or handling a content based on color. How you want to, or your audience to read the images becomes of utmost priority to you for each and everything. Okay, so the look, the feel, when we discussed about it all over today, is about, it starts from the beginning. And there's a lot of things, a lot of understanding, a lot of technology, a lot of permutations and combinations. And something which I really tell today everybody, the biggest devil today is our displays. How one is going to read the images on their house television or on their mobile phones, in what conditions, is something which none of us today can control. So that is something which has been trying to work out by various organizations here in the world today, and the challenge is big. But beyond that, what color does to you is, it makes you feel happy, it makes you feel sad, it makes you, it confuses you, and it just is a wonderful thing today. You know, it's a very volatile subject, and it's a very beautiful thing that you play with colors. It's like Holi. You know, sometimes the colors are beautiful, sometimes they just come on you. It's a wonderful world to be in. Though challenges are huge, you have to handle various things, you have to understand all these aspects about psychology, the balances, the volume, the cameras, the color spaces, display mediums, the amount of light that has been used there, how many shades are going to be seen, what colors are going to get interpreted. So all these things are going to be really quite a challenge for all of us to be a part of it. And as you told rightly, Manoj, there are a couple of things that we have been planning. So we will talk about it in the coming days for sure.
Thank you very much, Rahul. That was a fantastic masterclass. You showed a lot of insight on the various aspects of color. There are a lot of other aspects which we need to touch on, which relates to understanding of various technical aspects of cameras, lenses, lights, compositing, color rendition. That would be for another day, where we have a much larger time frame where we can tackle these subjects. Definitely looking forward to scheduling another session with you. Thank you so much.
And thanks, Manoj, once again. But there's somebody who also needs to be thanked, who's sitting right across behind the camera. That's Gautami. So she has helped me and both of us to put this in this very pandemic to really help us out. And thanks, Gautami, for your help in this very thing. And it's been wonderful to have you around and shoot here. Thanks to FutureWorks also for letting that space here in the conference room where we could go and do a recording. It's safe, secure, and we have sanitized it. So thanks, everybody, and for the whole thing.
अक्सर लोग मुझसे पूछते हैं कि मेरा सरनेम क्या है, जाति क्या है, धर्म क्या है। और मैं उनसे मुस्कुरा के कहता हूं कि इस देश के नाम पे मेरे बाबूजी ने मेरा नाम भारत रखा। अब इतने बड़े नाम के आगे जाति, धर्म, सरनेम लगा के ना तो अपना और ना ही इस देश का मान कम कर सकता हूं।
जो आया है वो जाएगा भी, बस मर्जी हमारी होगी।
गद्दी पे चाहे हम रहें या मुन्ना, नियम सेम होगा।
और हम एक नया नियम ऐड कर रहे हैं। मिर्जापुर की गद्दी पे बैठने वाला कभी भी नियम बदल सकता है।
गुड्डू पंडित वापस आ गए, वो जाएंगे नहीं। अगली बार दुश्मन हाथ लगा तो बचेगा नहीं।
पापा की विरासत ये तो नहीं हो सकती ना कि दो लौंडे बीच चुराए तो उन्हें मार के चले जाए।
तो उसके लिए तो मिर्जापुर लेना होगा ना।
आप ही का मन था ना कि आपकी बेटी मिर्जापुर पे राज करे। बड़ी ना सही, छोटी करेगी।
मुख्यमंत्री जी, हम पर्सनली आपके वोटिंग परसेंटेज बढ़वाएंगे
तो हमारे पार्टी की छवि
वो भी ठीक हो जाएगी।
बिहार में आपका स्वागत है।
दद्दा त्यागी बहुत बड़े आदमी, बड़ा दबदबा है उनका।
शेर के मुंह को खून लग चुका।
शेर की उम्र ज्यादा है लेकिन बूढ़ा नहीं हुआ है वो।
तुम्हारे दद्दा है जब लेने जाते हैं तो सीढ़ी लगती होगी या खुद ही चढ़ जाते हैं?
दद्दा होते एक मिनट में मां चुद देते। अभी
सीढ़ी तो उसके लिए भी लगती होगी।
स्वीटी का उधार हम पे चुकाना है।
अब हमको बदला भी लेना है और मिर्जापुर भी।